John, let's talk about the aviation sector. From your vantage point, the recent air incident, what kind of effect is that on the industry? Has consumer sentiment changed at all?
I don't think sentiment has changed. I think air travel is still a necessity. It's not something that people, you know, use as discretionary. You know, people do fly on business. People do fly on vacation. The world is a very small place today as a result of air travel. We can get anywhere in the world today within 24 hours. Anyway, and I think that air travel is a facilitator that opens up the world to everybody. So I don't think issues that we've had recently with the commercial aviation environment should detract from people's confidence in flying. We've had incidents that would kind of crack the veneer of, you know, people's confidence in flying, but under no circumstances that we've seen the incidents recently, you know, taking the fundamental trust that people have in air travel.
With respect to, regulatory requirements, has there been a request to ramp anything up or an overhaul or change of any sorts? Have you heard of anything like that?
Yep. And we've seen evidence of that south of the border. I think that the latest Alaska Airlines plug detachment from the aircraft really brought the FAA, which is the regulatory body in the U.S. that certifies these aircraft, has brought a change in terms of their actions that they take in certifying airplanes. If you remember back in 2018-19, when we had the MAX aircraft crashes in Ethiopia and in Asia, the FAA only grounded the airplanes 3 or 4 months after the first incident. They grounded it quickly after the second one. But in this instance, the FAA took 12 hours to ground the MAX 9 plugged airplane fleet, which is, you know, unheard of in terms of taking that action that quickly. So the FAA, as a certification agency, as a regulatory body, is taking action when they see things start to fall between the cracks. There's no delay. They really react quickly, which is good for consumers.
Let's, take this conversation and maybe lead it into another one. Are you seeing, a change in aircraft orders, not necessarily based on something like we've been seeing in the last little while with respect to the incidents, but just overall, has there been a change when it comes to future contracts?
Yeah, I think that, you know, we have a duopoly primarily in the manufacture and delivery of commercial aircraft. Airbus and Boeing have, I'd say, not over 90% of the world's market when it comes to airplanes. And typically, over the last 20 years, since Airbus, you know, has gone into the narrow-body airplanes, the market's been split 50-50 between Airbus and Boeing. What we've seen in the last 4 or 5 years since the MAX 9 incidents, since the MAX 8 incidents, really, in Ethiopia and in Asia, the share has shifted. We now have over 60% of the world's market now buying Airbus. And if you want to buy an Airbus airplane today, you will not get delivery until the end of the decade. The line is that sold out. So Airbus has about 8,000 airplanes to deliver. Boeing has about 6,000 airplanes to deliver. So there is a shift away from Boeing into Airbus. And that is really, from my perspective, an existential issue for Boeing.
John, you had started this conversation talking about, consumer demand for travel. Just a follow-up to that, what is that demand then on jet fuel, given the economic landscape, inflation, cost of fuel? What does that look like?
I think that, you know, the cost of fuel is of concern to the industry. I think they're looking at all kinds of different ways to minimize their costs. They're looking at hedging. They're looking at advanced purchases of fuel. There's a new fuel being developed today called, you know, sustainable aviation fuel, SAF, that will change the emissions outlook for aviation. So there's a number of things happening on the fuel side, but fuel pricing will in fact very much impact the price of airfares.
let's talk about the price of airfares, and maybe let's talk about the domestic sector here specifically. What does that look like when it comes to the airlines? Is it oversaturated? Do you see, I guess, potential M&A activity playing out, and a price war perhaps between the aircraft carriers here in Canada?
We're in the middle of a price war as we speak. You know, the first quarter of any given year is usually the doldrums of demand for air travel, except for if you're going to the Caribbean or you're going for sun destinations, but domestic travel, mainly international travel, is typically quiet in the first quarter of the year. And that's typically where you see a lot of fare actions that try to stimulate travel. And this year is no exception. We have two ultra low cost carriers in Canada who have defined themselves as ultra low cost and are acting as low fares, Lynx and Flair. The problem is that those fares that they're charging to stimulate travel are non-compensatory. They're not generating any profits as a result of that fare war that's going on. Air Canada, WestJet, Porter are kind of playing along, you know, not being too far distant from these prices. So Flair and Lynx are the price leaders in Canada. Canadians are enjoying the benefits of our price war domestically. The problem is going to be, are these fares and these airlines sustainable? And the view is probably not, and we'll probably have one of those carriers subject to either bankruptcy or M&A.
We're still in the early days of Q1. How do you see summer travel playing out? I know that you had mentioned that there is a demand for travel, a need for business travel as well. What does the summer of travel look like?
It's going to be busy. I think we had a situation last summer where I had to characterize it as a return to a thriving aviation market. I called it revenge travel. People were coming out of COVID and really wanted to travel. And summer of 2023 was an exceptional year in terms of demand and profitability for carriers. I see the same thing repeating itself in 2024. The only damper might be recession, might be disposable income, but fares will definitely be up there. Canada's domestic fares will be significantly higher in July and August than they are today. So deals are now, they won't be there in the summer.